Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Redeemer Lutheran Church on this, the day that we celebrate Reformation Sunday. In the Lutheran Church, that has a special meaning for us because we bear the namesake of one of the many people who were a part of the early Reformation, or the Reformation that happened in 1517, Martin Luther. So we bear his namesake in this church, and today is the day that we celebrate the work of not only Martin Luther, but the many reformers who saw the abuses that were happening in the church and worked to correct them, Luther being a figurehead and, again, as I said, the one whose namesake we bear. Today we'll focus on a couple of texts. We'll be singing some Lutheran hymns that you're well familiar with, and celebrating a time that happened, well, over 500 years ago, and yet still has its roots in some of the issues and problems that we see even happening today. So we continue to pray, first a prayer of thanksgiving to our God that he has, through the time of the Protestant Reformation, revealed to us the truth of the gospel and the justification by grace through faith by Christ alone, and that Christ has died for you, and that is who we proclaim, and that's who we share, and the word has been made flesh, so we share him with you today. We'll begin our services with our hymn of the month, which is a good reminder of the message of the Reformation. It's Jesus Loves Me. We begin with song we sing. Invite the congregation to please rise for worship. We'll be following Divine Service Setting 2. If you'd like to follow along in your hymnals, you'll find that on page 167. We make our beginning this morning. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake he forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Our service continues with the intro it appointed for today. We speak these words responsively. I will speak of your testimonies before kings, O Lord, and shall not be put to shame.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I will speak of your testimonies before kings, O Lord, and shall not be put to shame. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us steadfast in your grace and truth. Protect and deliver us in times of temptation. Defend us against all enemies, and grant to your church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for our readings.
Our first reading today is from the book of Revelation, chapter 14. Then I saw another angel flying directly overhead with an eternal gospel to proclaim to those who dwell on earth, to every nation and tribe and language and people. And he said with a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of water." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is written in the book of Romans, chapter 3. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite the congregation to please rise as we join together and sing the Alleluia in verse.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia.
Hear now the Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son remains forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated as we sing our sermon hymn number 656.
Thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace be unto you all from God our Father and our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for today's message comes from a portion of the epistle lesson you heard read just a moment ago from Romans, the third chapter, specifically verses 20 and 21. I'd like to share those words again. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested, apart from the law, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Thus far, our text. Reality television. It's practically all that you can find as you flip through the channels on TV nowadays. As was predicted so many years ago with the advent of television shows like Survivor or the singing shows like American Idol and The Voice, you can see even today that reality television dominates the airwaves. I say prediction from so long ago because there was a time prior to the existence of reality TV when shows employed actors, professional actors, almost exclusively as the majority. But with the successes of reality TV, producers realized they could have all of the drama, all the personalities, all the action, minus the expense of the professional actors. The average Joe Schmoes of the world became primetime players. Why? They were cheap. Come up with the format, plug in the regular dude, the regular gal, fill the role, and voila! Now you've got yourself a show. So at the same time when the numbers of channels on your television proliferated, so also the numbers of nameless reality TV players grew, with shows of all kinds of variety available for your perusal. Some of these I personally sort of enjoy, or at least one time enjoyed. Most of them I can't stand. I know that comes as a real shock to you guys. One of the side effects of these reality TV shows is that ordinary Joes reveal their whole selves to the world. They go from being a nondescript, anonymous person one day to being a star, if that's what you want to call it, the next. Once relative unknowns are now the now known as reality TV stars, and in the process we see the reality of people experiencing the newness of celebrity. Now Joe Schmo has a stylist, wardrobe. They attend the premieres and they hobnob with the big cheeses. And once no names are now household names. From the Snookies, the Paulies, and the Mike the Situation on MTV's Jersey Shore, to the Sig Hansons and the Wild Bill Wachowskis on Deadliest Catch, to Elizabeth Hasselbeck, Boston Rob, or Parvati on CBS's Survivor, to one of the best of them all, Joe Exotic on Tiger King. We see people whose lives were once anonymous and maybe should have remained anonymous in the case of some of them, private in their dysfunction, now celebrating and selling their lives as the norm in the name of reality TV. I'm not sure if I'd call this a function of celebrity or the cause of it, or if it's actually just dysfunction. And you might say to yourself, yeah, Pastor, you've got to realize that's TV. This is the real world. To which I would respond, yes, but these shows are actually a reflection of what the real human situation is. It's inherent even in the name of the genre, reality TV. It's reality exposed. And what ends up being exposed is sinful human nature. Love, or maybe lust, is sold as something to be found on a two-week cruise or in a season on a show for bachelors or bachelorettes with multiple hot tub partners, I might add, by the way. Betrayal and backstabbing becomes, well, just a part of the name of the game. Hedonistic, boundary-free living gets sold as the norm. And all these situations are far more serious than Mike the Situation in Jersey Shore. We got to call them what they are. sin. Couldn't that be said to be true, that this is what they are? That the people that engage in this type of behavior are sinners? When reality TV is shut off and we're simply talking reality, then what are we? Wouldn't it be true that we're all just as full of the same dysfunctional issues that we can observe in stuff like this? True, we're not necessarily experiencing the same problems that these people do, and the television shows go to great lengths to exacerbate these issues, but it's also true that we do have our own baggage that we carry, our own realities. Thankfully, we can remain anonymous. We don't have to reveal our dysfunction, but at the same time, we don't get rewarded for it either, like these people are doing. Because we're not sharing our dysfunction, we can keep the curtains closed on what our problems are. And then what people see on the surface, well, maybe that can fool them into thinking that everything's okay down below. But the problem with that theory is that dysfunction always seems to find its way out, up onto the stage. For the reality TV persona, it becomes their persona to be put on display, but for others, maybe their personal myopia causes them to miss the manifestation of the sin in their own reality-filled lives. I know it, because as a pastor, I've seen it. I've had it shared with me, sometimes even when I wasn't looking for it. Listen to what it sounds like. I'm a pretty good person, Pastor. I haven't done anything that bad. It could sound like, I used to teach Sunday school when my kids were little, but now someone else can do it because I took my turn. I've heard stuff like this. Sure, I spend a couple of Sundays a year out on the golf course or fishing or in the deer blind or hungover after a big Saturday night when my team didn't do so well. I'm not just wearing red to go big red today. Big deal. I can make it to all the rest of the Sundays, Pastor. Bible study? Bible study? That's my time. I only get a little time every week to enjoy my weekend, my time on the weekend, so that hour I'm going to use for myself. I already know all that I need to know about the Bible. Don't you judge me, Pastor. Or it could sound like this. Well, okay, maybe we did sleep together a couple times before we got married, but hey, what's the big deal? Everybody's doing it, and we still got married. I've heard this one. I can't tell my grown kids what to do. I'd be a hypocrite to tell them that it's wrong to live together before they're married when I know, and they know too, that I was pregnant before I got married. How could I lecture them? I've heard this one too. I used to sin, but I don't anymore. Reality, folks. I've moved beyond that. Yeah, this is reality. These are all real examples from my experience as a pastor. And it shouldn't come as a surprise, because what are we in reality but sinners? Sometimes sinners whose sin is too close for them to recognize that that's indeed what it is. Pretty good people don't even realize that the very act of their self-justification is the spectacle that exposes them for what they are, sinners. And what's a good thing to do when you realize that you're a sinner? Well, sinful people make good candidates for a reformation, or a reformation, as it were. As I say this, it's obvious to all in the room that we're celebrating Reformation Sunday today. I told you at the beginning of services, that's what we're doing. We're singing A Mighty Fortress for our sermon hymn today. It's an event that's traced in our church's history to another time and another place some 500 plus years ago. A time when the leaders of the then church were saying, we're pretty good people. We're doing a pretty good thing. In fact, the church wasn't just pretty good. It was really good in its own eyes. So good, in fact, that it had excess good to share with others. It was willing to sell off to the others who weren't so good. It came in the form of indulgences, a document that allowed a person to get out of purgatory for free. The Roman Catholic Church was selling these indulgences, the excess good of some of the saints who were part of the church, so that others could be thereby rescued from the peril that awaited them in purgatory and even worse, hell itself. The church in Luther's day thought so highly of itself that it was a good candidate for reformation or a reformation because its problems were perhaps a little too close to be seen. But a reformation has to have a reason to start, a reason to get underway. And in the case of the Reformation of the 16th century, there was a man named Martin Luther. He was a simple monk, though measuring up what he saw in God's word against what he was observing in the church, realized that what was going on around him in the church didn't measure up. That the reality of the church in his day was not what it should have been. God's word doesn't make room for the selling of indulgences or relics or purgatory or the infallibility of one man's words over another unless that man is the God-man Christ. Instead, Luther found that God's word, the word made flesh, that same word of God that we read from today in Romans 3, showed all that was going around him, all that was going on around him, was just the opposite of what it should be. Luther read what we heard today. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. Luther saw a church that was not rooted in the gospel message of Jesus Christ, the propitiation for the sins of humanity. Luther saw a church who was trying to make its way through works completed, works of the law, by which not a church, not a person can be justified according to Romans chapter 3. Luther realized he was part of a church that had lost touch with reality. A church whose dysfunction had become apparent. It had become an institution based on merits and rewards, all the while missing the fact that the church was based on the foundation that is Christ Jesus himself. It was a church in need of a reformation. The church of Luther's day missed its problems, and the Protestant Reformation subsequently took off. After I said Luther was a figurehead, it was almost 200 years in the making. Certainly these seeds of the Reformation had been planted long before Luther came on scene, but he was the right guy at the right time to point out that they had pursued for many years a false reality. And the church with a capital C. Our church today, the church with a capital C, and specifically this church, Redeemer Lutheran Church, we are the lucky benefactors of the work of people like Martin Luther, Philip Melanchthon, Martin Chemnitz, and the like. And so on this Reformation Sunday and on all others, we praise God that the errors and the abuses that were corrected by these reformers, the teachings of these church fathers, have made their way down to us here and now today, so that the church can find itself reformed based on the gospel message of Jesus Christ through faith by grace alone. Or have we? Because if we had, as a church, been the benefactors of this, maybe pastors wouldn't hear comments of the like of the kind that I just mentioned a moment ago. Comments that betray the false reality of the people speaking them. It doesn't matter if you taught Sunday school years ago or if you teach it today. That isn't the point. We know this from the reformers. You're never going to earn your way to heaven by teaching or not teaching. But the children who are taught the gospel of Jesus Christ in Sunday school. They can receive faith and they can enjoy eternal salvation, which is a benefit of that faith if you do teach them. Thanks not to you as their teacher, but thanks to the Holy Spirit, the grantor of faith. It's true, we are free in the gospel. So if we miss church on a Sunday because we just so happen to be out on the golf course or fishing or in the duck blind or the deer stand or whatever, we won't be immediately struck down by lightning by God in that moment, hopefully. But we must also remember that when we skip, we open up chinks in the full armor of God that Paul exhorts us to put on by hearing the Word of God, by participating in the sacraments, by growing in the Word of God. We fail to put on that full armor. We give Satan an inroad to our very heart. And it becomes his opportunity to tell us that if you skip church, if you skip Bible study, and you do it just this one week, well then maybe that inroads leads to highways and byways. And now we skip another and another and another. And certainly it's not by works of the law of doing what God has told us that we'll earn our way to heaven, but we might miss the true road. And even though by our attendance in church we aren't earning our way to heaven by our works, pretty soon we risk thinking we know who Jesus is. We don't need church or a pastor or a Bible or anything to tell us. That's the kind of stuff you still hear as a pastor. Ah, I'm more of a spiritual person than I am a religious one. I've rejected religious institutions. Raising our children in the faith isn't a task that we complete because God loves those who do it right more than those who struggle with the job. But it's also not an excuse for not admitting our sin and guilt in front of our children, telling them where we went wrong in our past, in our lives, and trying to teach them right from wrong so that they don't repeat the errors of their own parents, even when we've done wrong in our past. When we raise our children in the true faith to know that Jesus can forgive sinners and that he asks us, no, he exhorts us to go and sin no more, well then, our children may pattern their lives after that too. Indeed, it's true. We strive and we sometimes fail to be pretty good people, but the truth is that being pretty good people will never get us to heaven. Ever. That's what Romans 3:20 teaches us. By works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. So armed with our true knowledge of our sin, we have to seek righteousness in another way, don't we? Which is where Paul comes riding in with the next verse, Romans 3:21, and he says, "But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law." The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Indeed, it is God's work. It's God's work to create, to sustain, to deliver faith to those who hear his word and participate in his sacraments. This is God's reality. God makes people righteous through faith in Jesus Christ. And faith comes, as the scriptures teach us, just a little later in the book of Romans, chapter 10, through hearing. You have to hear in order to have faith. And what do you hear? But you hear that there is a righteousness apart from God's law, a righteousness that comes through faith in Jesus Christ. And at the end of Romans chapter 3 in our reading today, we hear that God justifies sinners, not because they deserve it. No, this is the message that the Reformation recovered for us. God saves sinners not because they deserve it, because of their good works, but because God loves. Simply put, you guys know the passage, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Whosoever believes in him should never perish, but would have eternal life. Yes, you, the people of God, the church gathered this day, you are saved in spite of your reality. You are saved in spite of the reality that you are a sinner. You are saved on account of Christ. And as a result, you have been reformed, made into something new through faith. Folks, this is the message of the Reformation. Your reformation. The dysfunctional reality of your sin has been reformed. It's been traded with Jesus at the cross, and his righteousness has been gifted to you. And now when God sees you, he doesn't see your dysfunction. He sees his Son, Jesus Christ. He sees Jesus in you, transformed into a shining star, just like God promised Abraham so long ago. And the name that was once a no name is now the name above all names. And you bear that name in you through faith. So for all who are in him, here are the keys to the kingdom through faith, brothers and sisters in Christ. This is the message of the Reformation, your reformation in Christ, until he returns. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We now have the opportunity to confess our common faith in the triune God using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Please stand as we join together and confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Please be seated now as we collect our gifts and offerings to the Lord and enjoy a time of special music provided for us by the Odyssey Children's Sunday School. As they're collecting the offerings this morning, also note that in the pew in front of you, you'll have a card. It's double-sided. On one side, it's for guests and visitors. On the other side, members, please fill out the appropriate side of the card. Once the offering basket is passed down your aisle, please place the card in the basket so that we can properly acknowledge your presence with us in worship today.
Sometimes it's days, sometimes
Thanks, kids. If ever you thought maybe there was sinners involved, just give kids sticks and put them in front of church and see, and then you know that there's reason for grace. And you heard them teaching, after being taught, that first commandment, love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. It's the first commandment that we're reminded. So you see the benefit of hearing these words as they're taught them, and you hear the grace that God gives through his son, Jesus Christ. I invite the congregation to please rise as we join together for the prayers of the church. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious God, you have renewed your church in every age with the voices of those who recall your people to all the gospel and who speak your word in all circumstances. So receive our thanks for Martin Luther and for all those who are with him who contended for the gospel against many and great enemies. Make us bold in our day that we would also contend for the faith against those who would silence our voices or distract your people from the one true gospel of the crucified
and risen Christ. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, guard and defend us and your holy Christian church throughout the world, that we may be protected from the temptations of the devil, the world, and our own sinful nature. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, make us truly your disciples. Keep each of us in your word, and keep us free from all error, and make our homes and families peaceful. Preserve all fathers, encourage them for their godly task, that children would be brought up in the fear and instruction of the Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Have mercy on our nation. Give to us good and faithful rulers that will govern after your good pleasure, O Lord. Give us comfort and a right understanding of your rule in this world, that we would not be deceived to think earthly powers will last forever, but would instead have confidence in you and you alone. Your kingdom come, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of all grace, do not let your people fear, though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Rescue all who are in need or desire our prayers, especially those that are listed on our bulletin today or those we name before you in our hearts and minds this day. Comfort each of them with the promise that you are with them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have brought us by your word out of darkness and error into the light of your grace. Mercifully help us to walk in that same light. Guard us from error and false doctrine, and grant that we would not become ungrateful, despising your word, but instead that we would receive it with all our heart, and that we would conduct our lives according to it, putting our trust in your grace, through the merits of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue by singing the offertory.
What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits to me?
Who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever.
Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen. Please be seated as we sing our closing hymn, number 566.
Once again, a warm Reformation or Reformation Sunday welcome on behalf of the saints here at Redeemer Lutheran Church. What a great closing verse to our closing hymn today. For though I know my heart's condition, I also know my Savior's voice. It really is what's happening in church on Sunday. While the reality may appear that we have a lot of dysfunction that works its way to the top, the reality is that by hearing our Savior's voice, through hearing the word, faith comes, it says in Romans 10:17. And what's that word teach us? That we are saved by grace alone. So it's a great message and a great way to close out the service today. I'm going to share a couple of announcements with you, many of which are already in the bulletin and one that isn't. This week we have a meeting with our Stephen ministers and Barnabas ministers this coming Tuesday at 2 o'clock in the fellowship hall. Look forward to visiting with you all then. What was the other one that I was going to tell you that's in the bulletin, and now I just went completely blank on it. So I'll tell you the one that's not in the bulletin that we realized only right after we finished the printing of them, which is, guess what time of year it is? It's time for things to get darker and darker and darker. So for services next week, sometime Saturday evening into Sunday morning, you have to fall backwards with your clock. So if you show up for early services next week and nobody's here, you'll know why. Don't forget to set your clocks back this coming Sunday. I apologize that we didn't get that into the bulletin, but just know that that's what's happening. But know also this, that the light has come into the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There will be light again. You guys know when we turn with the winter solstice, with the light getting brighter and brighter and brighter, we're going into the darker and darker, darker season of the month here, where we get less and less daylight. But then it turns after Christmas, Christmas, that winter solstice, when from that time forward, the light starts to get brighter and brighter and brighter as the sun comes into the world. So we'll be setting our clocks back, enjoying an extra hour of sleep, I guess, next week. Try to show up on time. Have a blessed day and week in the name of the Lord.